We were in some high altitude. It's 12 degrees or worse below zero. You don't work fast in cold weather.
It's been a very tough movie in a sense that there's a snowstorm going on in the movie all the time. Whenever we are outside, we have to have the whole nature blanketed with snow and snow in the air.
The movie has a lot of big sets. When you're dealing in the scale of an airport, every set seems to become enormous.
It really just goes to your stomach and pulls you into it.
You're not quite sure who's wearing the black hat or the white hat.
Just like cowboys and Indians, modern-day cowboys and Indians.
I thought the first Die Hard was one of the hardest things I'd ever tried to do, but then I realized when I got into this one that the first one was a piece of cake.
Christmas in L.A., a strange way to spend the holiday season. You might remember John McClane. He celebrated with a bang. Die Hard made Bruce Willis an international movie star.
You are most troublesome for a security guard.
Sorry, wrong guess, Hans. Would you like to go for double jeopardy?
Only John can drive somebody that crazy.
It grossed over $200 million worldwide.
They have already killed one hostage.
This channel is reserved for emergency calls only.
Lady, do I sound like I'm ordering a pizza?
But most importantly, it blew audiences through the back wall of the theater.
Yippee-ki-yay, mother.
That was really, you know, the challenge for us, was to see whether or not we could match or top what we did in this huge, huge action film called, you know, Die Hard.
The challenge seemed overwhelming and devastatingly difficult to accomplish. You just have to die harder.
318, take 4,
I can
remember.
Die Harder.
Back on action.
Sound impossible? It almost was. The story of the making of Die Hard 2 is a saga almost as exciting as the movie itself. In the next half hour, we'll show you why.
Is what you expected?
No. This is just the beginning.
It's another year, another place, another Christmas. But it's the same old John McClane.
Cut me some slack, will you? Look, I used to be a cop in New York City. I only moved to L.A. because my wife took a job there. Come on, what do you say?
Bags over here!
Come on, man, it's Christmas.
So ask Santa Claus to give you another car. Merry Christmas, pal.
This time, he's in Washington, D.C.
It's all yours, Murray.
Waiting at the airport for his wife to fly in so they can spend Christmas with the in-laws.
Listen, honey, when you land, can we just, like, you know, rent a car, check into a hotel, leave the kids with your parents, order some room service, a bottle of champagne. What do you say?
You're on, Lieutenant.
It was going to be the perfect holiday until a group of former U.S. Army commandos turned mercenaries arrive at the airport to launch a diabolical attack.
Today at Escalon Airport in the Republic of Valverde.
Their mission, to free a deposed military strongman heading to stand trial in America.
Fire it up.
Yeah.
I hear you.
The problem's all over.
What's
the
it
airport.
Look like?
No lights.
Approach control, it's gone.
Instrument landing system is down.
Attention, Dulles Tower.
Who I am is unimportant. What I want, well, if you don't want those planes to start splashing into the Potomac because they run out of fuel, what I want is very important.
Your wife's plane? Well, they're still broadcasting, even though we can't answer. They're going to run out of fuel in 90 minutes.
And once again, a vacationing John McClane is forced into action. But this new turn of events leaves the sharpshooting L.A. cop pondering one inescapable question.
How can the same thing happen to the same guy twice?
If at times the odds confronting John McClane seem almost insurmountable,
we are just up to our neck in terrorists again, John.
The challenge confronting the crew of Die Hard 2 was only slightly less Herculean. The first, and perhaps the most pervasive challenge they faced, was the not-so-simple matter of the cold.
Okay, let's go.
This is logistically probably one of the hardest films that has ever been made here.
Keep moving around, folks. Keep moving around.
We've been averaging 10 degrees below, 15 below zero for a lot of nights now. It's just cold out here.
You know, crew has worked incredibly hard on this thing under probably the most adverse conditions that anybody's ever worked under.
It's a very serious situation.
It was so cold up in Denver that everybody bought these huge Arctic space suits, and the result was that nobody could tell who is who because everybody just looked like these mummies walking around.
Our director, Rennie Harlan, is from Finland, so he's used to the cold. He just keeps working along, and the rest of us are trying to get used to it.
I think for the crew it was much tougher because they are all Southern California wimps and they couldn't take it.
Let's just go right away, real fast, one more time.
Okay, resetting. It's a snow.
A snowy blizzard is an integral part of the Die Hard 2 story. And that means every time we're outside, every time we look outside, every time we even think about outside, it's got to be a blizzard. But finding cold weather didn't necessarily mean finding snow.
And sometimes the snow would just melt the moment we start shooting. We would land there, put our cameras up, and the snow will melt.
Cameras don't roll until I tell you, okay? You gotta wait for the snow to get here.
The snow actually turned out to be one of the characters in the film, and we had to move three or four times to chase the snow.
Easier to invade Normandy than it is to get this thing shot.
All right. Just stay here and get ready to call the Marines.
I thought they were the Army.
Right outside the snow! Okay, open the doors, please, for a second. Open the doors.
Major Grant, we're blue light.
Rollins, Department of
Transit. Trudeau, Chief of Air Operations.
Lorenzo, Terminal Police. You want something? You got it.
Bozo, in charge of the clowns.
Hey, what's happening, Bozo? I ain't seen you since Whistling Brothers,
brother. It's been a while, hasn't it?
Finally, when temperatures rose and the last snow melted, the need for on-screen flakes didn't dissolve with it.
We had Fox Studio buy for us a rather large ice chipping machine that chews up 300-pound blocks of ice in seconds. And we must have had a dozen 40-foot trailers loaded with 300-pound blocks of ice.
Spread out.
And as the 40-foot trailer moved along, the guys were holding on to that hose, and we were blowing chipped ice.
Conditions worsening, the problem here and in the sky above us will continue to grow.
Warm outdoor weather and large indoor sets required an avalanche of artificial snow. Concerned about the environment, the producers insisted that these flakes be biodegradable.
We used various types of plastic snow. We used foam, we call it JetX system. I've even resorted to going to a soap factory and having them take the soap part out of the flake they make and produce for me a flake big enough that looks like snow, just for ecological reasons.
Just as this storm starts breaking, the satellite feed up and drops the other shoe on. Look at this new front moving in.
I don't know about you guys, but I've seen enough snow to last me a lifetime.
Still have some snow in my ear.
To appreciate the enormity of the task, watch the following sequences closely. It required filming in 8 different locations to create the illusion of this single scene.
Go to Papa, scumbag.
Okay,
Coming up next, the secrets behind the dazzling special effects and spectacular stunts of Die Hard 2. There are many possible ways to die harder, but the greatest challenge of all was to die bigger.
It's a big picture. Big, big, big.
The sheer scope and staggering premise of Die Hard 2 created a unique set of problems for the talented production team. And none was larger than the task of constructing a major metropolitan airport, complete with a 10,000-foot runway, all within the confines of a soundstage 200 feet long.
We first had to figure out the scale of an actual airport, and then shrink it down to the size it would fit in the stage. There's really a gag in here where all the runway lights go out. They're turned off by the terrorists. We had to be able to build that in model form. There was no other way of doing it because of the snow problems. We couldn't make snow in front of an optical effect.
Go to emergency ladder now.
Emergencies, we are in a code yellow.
Backup systems won't come up.
Sent to another terminal.
Bobby, what do you got?
Please respond.
Nothing, the whole network is down.
So we built the whole air traffic control tower on one stage and surrounded it with a gigantic miniature set where we see the runways and the airport terminal buildings and hangars and planes taking off and landing.
So what's going on? I'm on approach.
Azure Sky, maintain position, repeat.
From the largest sets to the most minute details, even the control tower instruments were redesigned to heighten their visual cinematic impact.
This is what would be the TRACON room, the approach control facility of the airport. We built this up to simulate where the traffic would be handled.
What's going on down there?
Roger, we're on it, we're on
Western, we're unable right now, please delay.
Fuji 604, execute published missed approach procedure and hold.
We had to create all that software for it in a graphics program for a computer. It's quite an involved process just to get a little information on the screen.
600 feet.
Activate the ILS landing system, but recalibrate sea level. Minus 200 feet. Attaboy, we've got you. We've got you.
They'll fly right into the concrete.
And what airport would be complete without airplanes? Customized, of course.
They have a full-scale wing of a 747 that we've been shooting on.
We are rolling into the wind. Close the flap.
Making those planes fly was a mission requiring the technical assistance of the special effects wizards at the Industrial Light and Magic Workshop.
Basically, we're just laying down a huge carpet of smoke, and we're hoping that the wind will come back so that the wind will just carry that carpet of smoke off down the runway. Bring the front of the shot picker right there and reach over. We can probably reach the same distance, can't we?
Let's go down and talk to Dickie about that.
Even if we back up and we hang the airplane up above the smoke, the airplane doesn't move, but since the smoke is moving underneath it, the camera doesn't know the difference and it looks like we're flying among the clouds.
There we go.
Better.
It's called sci-fi acting, is what we call it. It's reacting to things that aren't there. Looking out the plane window and what, you know, obviously the illusion is when you see the film that there are clouds going by the window and I'm going to be on an airplane. And in fact, I'm looking out the window at a bunch of grips, you know, blowing smoke and, you know, waving things and, you know, blinking lights. And
caught? Good.
He's getting a little too low.
I was just wondering, this flight originally was supposed to be 5.5 hours, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do we have enough fuel to keep circling like this?
Oh, of course. They anticipate little problems like this.
I think the thing I have loved most about working on these Die Hard movies is I really feel like I'm participating in that Hollywood, legendary Hollywood illusion.
But the real fun came when it was time to blow up the planes.
They
Ladies and gentlemen, as you've probably noticed, we've started our descent. We're sorry for the inconvenience, but we'll all be on the ground in a few minutes.
All the plan!
But before the final explosion could be filmed, it required several tests, like this one, for the crash of a mythical British airliner.
This is the third test we did. We did a few more up in Northern California just to get an idea of what mixture we wanted.
Approach flaps.
Approach flaps.
And now it was just a matter of how often or how quickly the bombs were going to go off.
Approach speed 140.
Approach speed 140.
The editors will get, you know, a couple more cuts out of it, a little more drama.
Watch this.
We shoot a real plane landing. Then we shoot miniatures actually crashing. And then we use actual real life plane wreckage for the aftermath sequence.
If you think blowing up a plane is exciting, it can sometimes pale in comparison to the many outrageous action-packed stunts that have become a signature trademark of the Die Hard series.
And at the end of the chase, there's a big giant mogul. It's kind of near a highway. And he jumps this big hill to get away from them. And as he does, he goes over a truck. And as he does that, they're firing at him. They blow the snowmobile up, and he gets blown off it. In other words, as he's jerked off the bike, he trips the explosion, and off he goes. And it blows up at the same time. So it's kind of a spectacular stunt.
Boom!
It's just like that.
Boom!
That's better.
Oh. Bruce Willis wants to do his stunts himself.
Right here.
Boom!
That's it.
Charlie and I have to calm him down and tell him not to do them because we want to keep him alive and well so that we can shoot also the following day.
Take it!
Bullet hit where? Right here over my head here? When the bullet hits go off here, I'm going to go, boom, you lose me? Can we see it again one more time?
There's only one way to really make it look like you're trying to kill someone, and that is to try and kill them.
He's got away with a gun going down, right?
Okay.
Does that look pretty? I would feel a lot better about it if you put a pad on. If I come up with another one just like this, where would you kick me?
Where do you have to turn me?
Here?
And they hit like that, right? You're right here. When they go over, you should wind up like that.
Down. Oh, I bet it hurts. But it's pretty great.
Freeze! Nice guess. I'm a cop. That was a bad guy.
He's very cautious, very careful about what he does.
But for the most part, Bruce Willis is running around. He's got his hands full with stunts.
We have a scene where we actually fly a real helicopter over the wing of a real 747.
You want a cowboy ride too rough?
I don't like to fly.
Then what are you doing here?
I don't like to lose either. Bring it in low! Keep over the wing!
And I jump out of it onto the wing, and we proceed to have a huge fight with two different guys on the wing of a moving 747. I don't think that's ever been done.
When the challenges have been met and the problems overcome, hard work and creativity can turn a logistical nightmare into a high-flying cinematic triumph like this.
We had to not take ourselves so seriously. I mean, we're really asking the audience to kind of buy into the fact that this huge coincidence happens that I am once again in a place that happens to be taken over by terrorists. I think we ask the audience to kind of just come along with us again.
Shh. It's okay. I've done this before.
Now, you're the wrong guy in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Story of my life.
The cast and crew of Die Hard 2. You've seen their dedication. You've witnessed the scope of some of the challenges they conquered. In the end, the making of Die Hard 2 is proof positive that when it comes to creating action, adventure, and excitement, only the sky is the limit.
How many grenades we got?
Three each!
Use them!
Last time, it blew you through the back wall of the theater. This time, it will blow you out of your seat. And where does John McClane go from here?
I don't really know where to go. I mean, the only thing that he could do after this would maybe be to save the planet.
Working on the lines, right?